Good evening. Welcome to our Bible study as a continuation of the importance of the church in the life of the believer. Let us have a word of prayer. Our Father and our God, we are so grateful again for just the blessings that you have bestowed upon each of us. And as we come now to study your holy word, we ask now that your word will become a light upon our pathway. Help us to take your word and hide it within our hearts in order that we may not sin against thee. God, allow your word to be so forceful in our lives that it will teach us how to live here on this earth and prepare us for the life to come. We just thank you for being the God of our salvation. Bless us now as we shall study together your holy word. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Tonight, as we begin this message on the importance of the church in the life of the believer, we need to ask ourselves the question, what does a spiritual church, a spiritually healthy church, look like? And that can really be a tough question, especially when we get into the details of what the term spiritual and healthy mean. Yet growth is an essential ingredient of health and a living organism. And the church is a living organism. It's not an organization. It's an organism because we have a head. And the head of the church is Jesus Christ himself. And therefore, this living organism called the church is the body of Christ. And a healthy church must also be a growing church. As we study this lesson, there are two questions that I think need come to mind. And the first is my church spiritually healthy? And secondly, am I a spiritually healthy member? And if not, how can I improve? Viewing the church as the body of Christ offers us a helpful way to develop an awareness of how the Holy Spirit is at work in the congregation. Not long ago, I went to my doctor for my annual physical. The appointment began with taking my pulse, temperature, blood pressure, and weight. After that, I had to give some blood that was sent to a lab in order to check my blood sugar, my cholesterol level, liver and kidney function. Those tests offered insight as to what's happening on the inside of my body. If something is wrong, the test offers my doctor the direction as a treatment, or at least for the next round of tests. In the same way, there are some vital signs that offers insight into the health of a spiritually healthy church as well as a spiritually healthy member. Last week we talked about the symbols of the church, they being the body, the building, and the bride. And again, tonight we'd like to continue on by looking at the seven marks of a spiritually healthy church. When we start looking according to the Apostle Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 2, a church is a spiritual house. But what is it that indicates spirituality? Is it a loud church service filled with the sounds of enthusiasm? Is it using the proper religious language and jargon? While it isn't wrong to have enthusiasm in the church, these things alone aren't dependable indicators of a spiritual church. In fact, no church would be any more spiritual than are the members who are part of that congregation. This is the key to the spirituality of any church. One cannot read the book of Acts, and particularly chapter 2, without finding a church that was truly a spiritual church. There are several marks of spirituality found in this chapter of the Bible, seven traits of a truly spiritual church in Jerusalem. And as we look this evening at them, let us be mindful of the leading of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will mold each of us into the kind of church member that can help produce a more spiritual church. Therefore, the first spiritual sign, or the first vital sign, is that a spiritual church must be a church where there is prayer. The church at Jerusalem had its start after a great prayer meeting. All you have to do is read the Bible, and you'll see within Acts chapter 1 and verse 14 where the Bible says, "And they all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers." Notice in Acts chapter 4, verse 31, the Bible says the place was shaken when they prayed. And the results of prayer was greater boldness to proclaim the message of our gospel. The average church member, I believe, today spend less than 20 minutes in prayer, but we spend hours reading the newspaper, hours listening to music. We'll spend hours watching television, or even being on our laptops, our iPads, our computers, but yet we don't spend enough time in prayer. And really, could this be the reason we lack the power of God in ministry? Is this the reason that we are lacking the power of God even within our own life, because we fail to pray? And prayer is not simply going to God, asking God, "Give me this and give me that." But prayer is being in communication with God, being in dialogue with God, our talking to God, and then our allowing God to talk to us. All of our prayers should have elements of confession, adoration, thanksgiving, intercession, petition, and meditation. When we are praying, it's really human weaknesses crying out to divine strength. When we pray, it is saying that we recognize that there is someone who is higher and more powerful than we are. There would be more power in our Sunday school classes, more power in our choirs, more power in ministry, more power in the pulpit. In fact, there would be more power in our own home if we who are members of the church would just pray more. In a spiritual church, again, there must be prayer. And again, all of our prayers should not just be "give me, give me, give me," but there ought to be prayers of gratitude to God, where we're thanking God for what God has already done. We've all heard that old saying, if God doesn't do anything else, he's already done enough. So we need to be grateful for what he has already done. Secondly, in a spiritual church, there will be unity. When you read again within Acts chapter 1 and verse 14, and then continue reading in Acts chapter 2 and verse 1, it says, "And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all together in one place on one accord." Notice now, they were found together in one place and on one accord. They were unified. There was no division to be found among the members of the church. There was no sides to take. There was no fussing. There was no arguing. There was no hurt feelings. There was no person talking about, "I'm more important than you." No, they were all on one accord. This church meeting was an example of how they worked together and how we should be working together in perfect unity. The most important ingredients within a body, church body, other than the power of God, is unity. We can't have God's power when there is no unity within the body of Christ. Just think about it. What if your feet just decided on its own that we were not, that your feet were not going to cooperate with the rest of your body? Can you see the dysfunction that would have? Can you see all of the pain, all of the anguish that would cause within your own life. And division is one of Satan's most often used tools within the church. A spiritual church must have spiritual people who will serve spiritually together. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 3 says, keep the unity. If we are to do that, we must learn the principle. If you keep reading within the book of Ephesians, for when you are angry, you give a mighty foothold to the devil. And could it be that's the reason that many of our churches are having problems? Because we have given Satan a foothold into the church because we do not have the unity. Where there's unity, there's strength. So in order to be a spiritual church, a spiritually healthy church, we must have prayer, we must have unity. But then the third thing that we need is that the church must have fellowship. Acts chapter 2 and verse 42 teaches that the church at Jerusalem continued in fellowship. By definition, fellowship means to share interests, to share feeling, companionship with other people. To walk in fellowship with others demand that there is an agreement upon the essentials of the Christian faith. Amos tells us, for how can we walk together with your sins between us? Amos tells us that we've got to have togetherness. We've got to have fellowship one with the other. Fellowship means warmth. Fellowship means friendliness and concern for one another. And without these three, Christian grace, no church can truly be a spiritual church. Now, one of the things that we can really say is that we do know how to fellowship within the church. Our family life centers, our fellowship hall, all lends to great fellowship. Where we share meals together, because it's hard to eat with a person without talking to that individual. So that's a part of the fellowship that we share with one another. In fellowship, we learn more about that individual. Not only are we acquainted with the person, but fellowship helps us to have a relationship with that individual. And within the body of Christ, there ought to be a relationship among all of the members. In a spiritual church, a spiritually healthy church, there must be some giving. It's impossible to be spiritual and to be stingy at the same time. Now, I know someone is probably saying, there he goes, he's talking about money. But when we look within the Bible in Acts chapter 2, verses 44 through 45, it teaches us of a great willingness on the part of the Christians in the church at Jerusalem in order to give. No church will ever grow without a spirit of sharing. Giving is a matter of the heart. Giving is an indication of our love for one another. Therefore, a spiritual church must also be a giving church. When we talk about giving, we're talking about our stewardship back to God. And giving, yes, we do give of our financial resources. When we look in the book of Malachi chapter 3, it talks about our tithes and our offering. And it says, will a man rob God? And he says, before you answer that question, let me go on and answer it for you. Said, yes, a man will rob God with our tithe and with our offering. If I was to go out and rob Bank of America, Wells Fargo, or some financial institution, I would put a mask on because I would not want people to identify me. But there's a great robbery that takes place, a great holdup that takes place every Sunday morning in churches all across this land and country when we rob God within our tithe and with our offering. Tithing is not for the benefit of the church, but it's for the benefit of the individual. Because if one keeps reading the book of Malachi chapter 3, it says that he will open up windows of heaven for us, pour us out blessings that we won't even have room enough to receive them. Keep reading it. It says that he will keep the devourer away for our sake. God really says, try me and see if I won't do what I have promised. The question is not if God will do. The question is, will we do? But not only are we to be good stewards of that in which God has entrusted in our hands financially, but are we good stewards of our time, of our talents, of our influence? Are we giving God a portion of our time? Do we tithe back to God our time? So in order to be a spiritually healthy church, we must also be a giving church. Next, a spiritually healthy church, there's going to be some Bible teaching as well as some Bible preaching. One of the best ways to grow in the spirit is that you've got to spend time in the Word of God. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 2 says, as newborn babes desire the pure milk of the Word, that you may grow thereby. If we fail to maintain a strong course in the area of teaching, if we fail to maintain a strong area in the course of preaching the Bible, we will soon have a church filled with spiritual babies who haven't grown in the Lord. Spiritual people are those who enjoy listening to the Word of God. As the Word of God is taught, as the Word of God is preached from the pulpit. Now, all of us should know the story. There was a time within the church when preachers would preach and they would say, and you know the story. But many people today don't know the story. They don't know who went up the sycamore tree because they have not spent time in the Word of God. Notice again, even in Acts chapter 2, verses 41 and 42, how the Word of God was received, because verse 42 says, and they continued in the doctrine. Notice, they continued in the apostles' teaching. They continued in the Word of God. The Bible tells us even in Acts chapter 6 and verse 7, then the Word of God spread and the numbers of disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were obedient to the faith. The Bible hadn't lost its power to convict and to convert and to change lives, because there's power within the Word of God. A spiritual church will be a church where the Word of God has primary importance. The spiritual church, primary importance is the Word of God. The Word of God is not secondary. The Word of God is not something that we just deal with when we don't have anything else to deal with, but it is the primary thing that keeps us going. There is power, wonder-working power, in the Word of God. Then, a spiritual church, a healthy church, is a church that has joy and a gracious testimony. And you ought to pay close attention to those two small but often overlooked portions of the scripture. Acts chapter 2 and verse 46 says, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart. There was a joy evident in the lives of the people in Acts chapter 2. There was joy in their life. We need not walk around with a sad countenance on our face, but we need to be joyous people. We need to be people that even though things may be going wrong in our lives, but we need to have a smile on our face, knowing that the God that we serve will see us through. Because if you have the joy of the Lord, be able to say like the songwriter, this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it away. When visitors enter the door of your church on any given Sunday morning, do they find people who show the joy of the Lord by the way they look, by the way they act, By the way they walk? By the way they talk? Or are they finding individuals with that sad countenance on their face as if the Lord hasn't done anything for them? Verse 47 said, having favor. They had a gracious testimony which was attractive to other people. One minister used to say, if you build a fire in your church, the people will come and get warm. Story is told about this atheist who used to go and stand in front of the Baptist church, and that was before the time of air conditions, and the doors of the church were literally open. And he would never come in the church, but he would always stand on the outside. And the ushers would come and invite the man to come in, and he would tell them, no, I don't believe in your message. He was an atheist. And one day one of the ushers asked him, said, well then, why is it that you come Sunday after Sunday, stand in front of our church, and never come in? He said, I come because I enjoy that man in the pulpit catching on fire for what he believed. The question is, are you on fire for the Lord? The question is, do you have a testimony that you can share for the Lord? It's a cold world in which we live in, and we have to have a warm testimony for those individuals that we're coming in contact with on a daily basis. If you remember within your Bible, there was a time once when Jesus had gotten off a boat. He went into the cemetery and he was met by a man who was possessed with demons. He got the demons out of the man, and the man says to Jesus, Lord, let me go with you. Let me become a living, walking testimony of what your power is all about. Jesus says to the man, no, I don't need you to go on this evangelistic journey with me. You go back home to your family, go back home to your friend, go back home to your loved ones, and tell them the great things that the Lord has done for you. I believe that all of us have a testimony. All of our testimonies are not the same. We don't have to know the Bible from Genesis to Revelation in order to share what the Lord has done for us. If you share your testimony, that's the most powerful witness that you have for this cold, dark, dismal world in which we live right now. A spiritual church is a church where there will also be evangelism. And you ought not overlook Acts chapter 2 and verse 47, because it ends with these words, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. As these church members went out into the surrounding area, and let me just use it from this context, as they went to Renz, as they went to Waynesboro, as they went to Hepzibah, Blythe, as they went to the surrounding areas, they shared Jesus Christ. They did their best to tell others what Christ had done for them. And the very best advertisement in this world is word of mouth. And they spread the word. God bless daily with people being saved. God bless by adding to the church daily. Think of the great potential for church growth if each member determined to find just one person in need of a savior each year and bring that person in. What growth that would be. Spiritual members make up a spiritual church. And as spiritual members, we've got to have a testimony. We've got to be involved in evangelism. When you look at Matthew chapter 28, he tells us to go ye therefore into all of the world. And he says, and when you go, make disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit. And then he says, teach them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the ages. This thing called evangelism is not just for the preacher, but this thing called evangelism is for the entire church. One of the things that I noticed in growing up, my grandmother loved to go fishing. But I always noticed that she never fished from the house. She would prepare her lunch. She would prepare her tackle box, and she would take her pole. She would go out to the lake and she would do her fishing. Sometimes she would come home, had no fish at all. She said, "All I did today was feed the fish." It's our responsibility to do the evangelism. It's God's responsibility to do the saving. You may plant the seed. That's just feeding the fish, as my grandmother would call it. Someone else will come along and spread the word in evangelism, and that person then will be saved. Your responsibility, my responsibility, the responsibility of all members of any church is to just share the good news about Jesus Christ. A story is told about a man who missed church. And this is why the church attendance is so important in the life of the believer. What does one miss when you miss not being in church on a Sunday morning? I think many of us, since we've been going through this coronavirus episode and pandemic, we can feel what it feels like to not physically be in the building. And remember now, the church is not just the building itself. We talked about last week the church being the body of Christ, the church being a building, and the church being a bride. This building at 1714 Olive Road is just where the church gathers together. Because of this coronavirus, because of this pandemic, the church has been deployed to do the work of our Savior. But what do we miss when we don't come to the building itself? A wonderful story is told about a disciple named Thomas. And I believe that Thomas best illustrates what one missed by skipping church. If you look at John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31, you will find a story about this disciple just after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Verse 19 tells us it was the first day of the week, and the disciples, they all were assembled together. This would, of course, be Sunday evening when God's people had joined together for a meeting. What a good example of what takes place in church every Sunday. Verse 24 lets us know that Thomas was not there with the rest of the disciples that Sunday night when Jesus came. What did he miss by not being in church that Sunday night? First of all, he missed out on the fellowship with the other believers. And believe it or not, I think many of us can testify and attest to the fact that we have missed the fellowship of the people that we normally sit on the pew with. We've missed the fellowship of going around hugging and kissing and shaking hands. Christian fellowship is a vital part to the spiritual health of any saved person. By skipping church, you miss this great source of strength for your own life. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 14 says, "A love for the brethren, other believers, is evident of salvation." Secondly, the Christian life consists of three things: worship, stewardship, and fellowship. The Christian life consists of worship, stewardship, and fellowship. Thomas missed the Lord's blessing that all the others received. The Bible says in John chapter 20, verse 19, "Peace be unto you." A good church helps keep the peace of God in the Christian heart, as well as in the home of that individual. It's when one separates himself from other believers that he makes himself an isolated target for the devil. In John chapter 20, verse 19, we see that Jesus pronounced, "Peace be unto you." A good church helps keep the peace of God in the Christian's heart as well as in the Christian's home. It's when one is separated from other believers that he makes himself an isolated target for the devil. Verse 20 says, "And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were then glad when they saw the Lord." The disciples were glad. Thomas missed the joy shared by those who was present that night. And a great number of Christians lose the joy of the Lord in their life after skipping church for an extended period of time. Thomas also missed the Lord's great commission and the command to the disciples when he told them to go out and to share their witness. Thomas also missed one of the most important things. He missed the filling of the Holy Spirit. Because verse 22 says, "And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit." The filling of the Holy Spirit is reserved for obedient Christians. We need God's power to do God's work effectively. And that's why we need the filling of the Holy Spirit in order to go about doing the work of the Lord. By missing this meeting with others, Thomas was ashamed. He was embarrassed when the Lord returned. Finally, let me just ask, how many Christians would be ashamed if Jesus returned again on this Sunday and we were not in church? Not just the building, but as I said in a message, wherever we are, we can erect our sanctuary. How many people would be ashamed if the Lord returned because we are not in the sanctuary? Again, let me thank you for sharing in this Bible study, and never underestimate the importance of the church in the life of a believer, because a church is like a fireplace. When you reach into a fireplace with a poker and remove a live coal, that coal will, little by little, lose its light, lose its warmth, until it ceases to burn at all. But as long as that coal is in the fire with other coal, then the light will continue to glow. I challenge you, continue to glow for our Lord. Let us pray. God, we thank you again just for the privilege of the study of your word. And Father, we pray now that you would help us to be the church that you are calling for and that this world so desperately needs. Thank you for your church, and help us to be good stewards over all that you have entrusted into our hand. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen, amen, and amen. And may God bless you and keep you.